dynamic Rubina Karore is the director and chief curator of India's first private art museum, the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art in New Delhi. Postgraduate specializations in art history and education led her to teach art history and aesthetics at various institutions in Delhi, including the Jamia Millia Islamia University, College of Art, the National Museum Institute, and the School of Art and Aesthetics in JNU. Donning the robes of a curator and writer, she has curated many thematic and monographic exhibitions and worked as project editor and author on various significant catalogues and books published on art. She was the co-curator of the first Asian art in Fukuoka, Japan in 1999, showcasing trends in contemporary Asian art. A Fulbright Fellowship at Mills College in California brought forth Resonance, her curated exhibition on 20th century California painters and sculptors from the museum's collection. In 2007, she a traveling exhibition, Tiger by the Tail, Contemporary Women Artists of India Transforming Culture at the Women's Research Study Center at Brandeis University in Boston. At the Kiran Nadar Museum, she has curated Open Doors, Time Unfolded, Crossings of Bodies, Armor and Cages, and most recently, Difficult Loves, that opened to the public on 30th January this year. We welcome you, ma'am.
It takes great passion and effort to energize spaces and work consistently, especially spaces which have remained outside the purview of mainstream art practice. Today morning, Alka was talking about the binaries of the center and periphery. And I myself feel at times that we tend to, in big cities, become very Delhi-centric or Mumbai-centric. So it's very interesting to see these fresh energies in regional spaces, coming out of regional spaces, and the way the field is opening up. It is rather very interesting. And I personally do feel the need increasingly more now with the responsibility of heading a young museum, the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art, which is perhaps the first private museum initiative in recent years. And it showcases modern and contemporary art of India and the subcontinent. An enthusiastic audience such as you is always brings a sense of great satisfaction and joy, especially to the speakers. And though there is a great emphasis on forms of talking about forms of art making, which are of course fundamental to the practice of art, I am also very interested in sites of reception, you know, especially being at the museum and how this whole ecosystem of art works. I'm really drawn and fascinated, and I wish to work on that. I'll just briefly introduce myself, because Bhavana mentioned that she never wanted to be an artist, and she always wanted to be in a gallery and sit in a gallery and work with artists. I, on the other hand, always wanted to be an artist, and I enrolled at the Faculty of Fine Arts in Baroda to be a painter, and I wanted very much to keep painting and be an artist, but it so happened that Baroda did not have a single student in art history department for 2 years, and so the VC said that if this is the third year and if we still don't have a student, we'll have to shut this department. And so I, who was doing really well in my painting, and I was enrolled in which was the last batch of students who did 5 years of bachelor's degree, where we do 2 years of learning everything from drawing, painting, printmaking, pottery to sculpture, and then decide what to be. Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, very well-known artist, he was my teacher. And Ratan Paremo was the dean then, and they called my father and me and said that, well, she writes very well and she has done commendable tutorials and she's expressive in writing, so why don't we shift her to the art history department? And that is how I went into art history by default, in one sense. And I told Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh that I was very interested in being an artist, and he said, you can always learn to paint. You can keep painting later, that doesn't matter. So I got drowned into books and into art history, and art history had, I was the single student who did bachelor's of art history then, and you can imagine the advantages and disadvantages of being a single student. But I could never go back to painting and never really became a Sunday painter. So this is how I went into art history. And I have been primarily a teacher. I've been teaching for the last 17 to 18 years, and then went into curating, writing, and now with the museum. I think all of this comes together. So just briefly, that the museum as such is a work in progress. I would not call it a full-fledged museum yet. And it's 3 years old. It opened in 2010 in a temporary location at the HCL facility. And I deliberately called it Open Doors, which was more literal and metaphoric. And the idea was that Kiran Nadar, who was an avid art collector and now, of course, the chairperson and founder of the museum, the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art, she was collecting art, and at some point she felt that art needs to be not collected and put into storage, because she was buying extensively, and she felt that it needs to be shared with the public. And obviously, when you look at Delhi and Noida, especially where this whole exercise began, really cities are growing so much industrially. We see their signs of growth and progress, and how much is happening in terms of construction. But really, do cities grow culturally is the question. And I think the dearth of such spaces, you know, where the visibility of Indian art can be there, is truly glaring. And I think this was one of the reasons, perhaps, that triggered the idea to really share this private collection and bring it into public domain. So this is how it started. And the first two exhibitions actually were about introducing this collection to people. So I'm not just going to speak much about it. But within a year, we actually moved to Saket. And it's very interesting that this is where I say sites of reception, because it's very interesting. You make art, and if there is nobody to view that art, what would happen? And yesterday, Sadanand also touched upon this, and many others. So did Professor Goswami, that where are the people? Where is art? I mean, where's the art audience? And truly in India, I feel that it has to start, before you build a museum, you will have to start developing a museum-going culture, you know, which is still in its infancy, if I can say. And there is such a disconnect between art and the public as such. And to think that a little group of artists or the art community comes to attend things is really what matters is not true, because actually museums are in the service of public. I think that is where it is, I think that is a really very pertinent point. And so we decided within a year to shift to Saket. So it was literally like, if Muhammad does not go to the mountain goes to Muhammad, because if the public could not come to Noida to the museum, we take the museum to the public. And now we are in a mall complex, a huge mall complex, in which we acquire 34,000 square feet. And that is where the museum is at the moment. This was the inaugural show at Saket, Time Unfolded. And then in 2012, we did Crossings. I'm just going to quickly show you some of this. In fact, the title I took came from Ranbir Kaleka's 4-channel video projection called Crossings. And I was very interested in the way the artist was exploring on these 4 canvases. He was doing 4 projections. And I love the idea of simultaneity and how one could, how his characters jump from one frame into the other. And they are actually occupying time and spaces of different kinds, you know, which is quite real and surreal at the same time. So dream and reality is colliding, past and present is colliding. And it even in terms of art practice of Ranbir, he started as a skilled painter and then goes into video and then uses both of them. You have the still image on which the projection is a moving image. I was very interested in these kinds of crossings, and therefore the title of the exhibition. And some views of crossings, as you can see, Akbar Padam Si, Tallur, and on the other side, Manjeet Bawa's miniatures. Vivan Sundaram's master plan, Adila Suleiman's sculpture, and Atul's shutter work. and in the other space Surendran Nair. And later on an event called Line of Control, where we installed, sometimes we stretch our necks out, go and fight with the DLF authority of the mall and tell them there is some need to do this, where you can actually bring art and take it into public space in the sense that it is within the mall, not inside the sanctified space in one sense of the museum. And this work of Subodh was very interesting because the way it got installed, it is a 36 feet installation, it has 36 parts, it weighs 20 tons. You need to go into the parking lot in the basement and strengthen the column. You need to take out glasses of the mall facades and get cranes and forklifts inside. So you can imagine. And all this really brought in conversations of different kinds with people, where we did a little project, you know, a feedback questionnaire was kept there, and all the people who came from the parking up into the mall were given this, and they were asked questions how they experienced this work, whether they touched it, whether they stood underneath, and whether they photographed themselves with it, or what did they do. And most of them had actually taken pictures on their mobiles with this sculptural installation. And then all these art general public had a desire to meet Subodh Gupta. So there was an evening done where he came and he actually spoke and met with all the people who were curious to know how this work was done and why it was done. And interestingly, the whole contrast and the duality and the paradox of India today, that you have these shining surfaces and such a huge excessive sculpture, and at the same time, how empty are these vessels, and how much does it talk about the duality of India. And today I'm actually going to focus and quickly run you through the anxieties of a curator, because last evening it was fantastic to hear Sadanand Menon talk about the anxiety of a writer and Anju talk about the anxiety of a painter or an artist. And I feel that where Sadanand said, we writing on art cannot be art, can it be called art? And sometimes this is the question that comes to my mind all the time, being also a curator of the museum, not just the director. What does curation mean to me? I constantly ask myself, what does it do? What does it mean? Because if we go by the Wikipedia term of curating, then the Latin term or the meaning is, it comes from, you know, being a keeper of objects or keeper of collection, and then tending the collection, looking after it, preserving it, you know, organizing it. Those are the kinds of tasks that a curator does. But is that all that is to curation? And I feel one of the challenges, which I find very interesting to work with, is that when you have a body of work, how do you really present it to the audience? That is the main question that a curator is asking. And of course, it is about providing a meaningful context so that the works can be comprehended and understood and appreciated or critically examined by the audience. And that is the role that a curator plays. And looking at the museum then, the four main areas of responsibilities that I head is shaping the museum, because it's a work in progress, shaping the collection, which is still growing from 250 works, it has now gone to 600 or more works, and looking after curating exhibitions and publications, and of course innovative programming which is very important for any museum to have, because of nurturing diverse kinds of audiences. So I will start with this exhibition, which is an ongoing exhibition, and it's called Difficult Loves. And it is a three-part exhibition. And I am just going to focus on how I worked on this curatorial project, and how there were things that I said I don't want to do, and a list of things that I wanted to do. And what I initially started with is the recent acquisitions that the museum has made. We have acquired the largest portrait, self-portrait that Amrita Shergill has painted, and it is now in the collection. And we had acquired Nasreen Mohammadi's works. And these two things triggered the idea of looking at the collection again and seeing what kind of artists we have recently looked at. And it's very strange that all the ones that I looked at were women, but I was not starting with the category of gender somehow. I was more wanting to look at through the artistic lives, examining the artistic lives of these women, and then coming to some kind of an exhibition that could put together. And that's also one of the reasons why I called it Difficult Loves, because it is about these intense journeys. I was very interested looking at their lives because of the kind of individual, the premium that they place on the choices they make, okay, and how these artists grapple with the self and the world, the materials they transform and the processes they grapple with, the eccentricities they nurture, and you know how they live with this, they just embrace love and anguish, and from that they create their art. And that was something that came very close to Amrita's life as well as Nasreen's life. But I was very conscious that I didn't want to do certain things. For instance, though we all know that Amrita had a very brief career and a very short life, just 28 years, and she was gone. And Nasreen Mohammadi had died when she was 53 years old and with a debilitating disease called chorea, which comes from the Parkinson's family, and she suffered a lot for many, many years. I was very wary of the fact that I did not want to either eulogize them or really start from any kind of sympathetic view, and yet wanted to look at how these two artists were legends in their own way, because they really also were artists who really stand for two distinct trajectories in art. One, of course, Amrita Shergill, who's very interesting also from the point of view that she is a figurative woman artist, you know, at a time when all in a very male-dominated society as well as art practice. And then she is looking at herself, and she paints the body and the figure. And it was very interesting to look how she really decided and worked towards taking the trajectory forward of Indian modernism. And on the other hand, somebody like Nasreen, very withdrawn from the world and working in the area of transcendental abstraction and working in solitude, was very interesting how these two artists could be looked at. And then I chose seven contemporary artists, were women, relatively younger generations, and how their practice, their recuperative practices and provocative practices really draw upon these language of both figuration and abstraction. And that was how I worked at these exhibitions. I will now... So Shergill, the self in making is what... And of course, I'm thankful to both Naveena and Vivan, because they were very generous in giving us loans of works and helping us out with this exhibition in terms of material. So this is a modest exhibition, and the Difficult Loves opened on January 30th, which was also the birthday of Amrita Shergill, and if she was around, she would have been 100 years old. And it's called The Self in Making because thematically, it only looked at her self-portraits. And I found her fascinating, because when I met Naveena, and the way that Naveena and Vivan have both documented and archived the material, it is really amazing, because it makes me think, when an artist is gone, really, what happens to a lot of things that an artist does, from writing letters, to making sketches, to really just scribbling something, to working on canvases, who takes care of all this? The curator is somewhere else, whoever the curator, but who is really going to take and compile and actually very methodically put this material together for reference and for future kind of exhibition making and curating? And which is what I found with both Vivan and Naveena. And when we were looking through these works, it's a very, very extensive archive. But what drew my attention was her drawings when she was 14 years, barely 14 years of age. And these drawings are all self-portraits. And it's very interesting. She's 14 years barely, and she is drawing herself. And that means that she is both the muse and the maker. Okay? She is looking at herself and she is drawing herself, both in terms of learning the skill or the craft of drawing yourself. You are looking in the mirror when you are drawing your self-portrait. And then you are understanding the structure of the face, the anatomy. And then you are also learning how you can actually take some liberties to transform it, so that you can show certain moods, some character. You can take on some kind of new identities. For instance, she sometimes drew herself as Beethoven or some other character that she was drawn to, or in the way that she donned herself in different styles, you know, the projections that she made on herself. And that was where I thought it was very interesting to look at what role does self-portraiture play. In fact, I think because she also extensively wrote letters, it's very interesting to find out how her psyche worked, you know. And there are instances where she wrote to her mother or someone else, even to Karl Kandalwala, the art historian, and things about sharing about herself, you know. One, I think one of the things says that to earn money, she painted self-portraits, okay. And when she moved to very social and stark subjects, maybe those works were not selling, okay, but self-portraiture was. The room is very simple. It has, on the one hand, the big easel painting where she poses in front as both. What I like about it is, it's a direct confrontation with the world, you know, through the self-portrait. And then she is very self-conscious of who she is, both as a woman and a painter and an artist. And then she dons up different kinds of ways of looking at herself. And you may not be able to see her, but I was fascinated when I saw that her self-portraits, in fact, actually can be a lesson in art history, Western art history, because she, you know, that she grew up with a dual consciousness. She had, you know, a Sikh father, Hungarian mother. She studied in Paris, painted in India, and she was shunting between India and Paris. And then when you look at these portraits, you see a Velasquez, maybe a Cezanne, you know, a Delacroix, a Rembrandt. I see all these styles in which she has actually painted her self-portraits, okay? And so, as young as that, from 14 onwards, how she was really making this identity of an artist, even before she became an artist, is very interesting. And I'm just going to read one of the quotes, because I think that really explains this little thematic exhibition, where she says, "It seems to me that I never began painting, that I have always painted, and I have always had with a strange certitude and conviction that I was meant to be a painter and nothing else." So that is Amrita Shergill, and the exhibition also has a loop of her, all her self-portraits, which are in the NGMA collection as well. There is an extensive text written by art historian Rakhi Balram, which is now going into the publication. It also has photographs by Amrita Shergill's father, Umrao Singh, which is a very interesting way to look at how she was photographed from her childhood till she lived. That's also part of exhibition. And if I go back, there is also Vivan's retake of Amrita. Very interesting two works, in which one you have her paint herself as a Tahitian woman, which brings in Paul Gauguin, and another with the portrait of Frida Kahlo. Coming to Nasreen, this is a retrospective and it's titled A View to Infinity, and that's Nasreen Mohammadi. I'm fortunate to say that she was my teacher, mentor, and my neighbor. And I spent a lot of time with her, and I had access to a studio. And that is also one reason how I was looking at these works. And interestingly, that question what I was talking about, that Vivan and Naveena have put the material together, in case of Nasreen, there are many, many question marks. When we were planning this exhibition, there was a lot of concern and apprehension raised by my boss, saying how would we go about doing this exhibition, because though she is an important artist, she remained literally outside the mainstream practice. She was not Her peers were all working in the figurative tradition, and she was working on something which was very different, and she quietly kept working. It's also true that when she passed away, a lot of her work, we do not know, a lot of her work is scattered in the sense that a lot of work was taken by international people who were visiting her or who were friends or critics outside India. And even with the family, things have been in different places. So when this exhibition was being planned, we had acquired only 38 works of hers, and the exhibition has shown 136 works of hers. So the job was to really source these works, if we had to really understand the life of this artist right from the beginning till the time that she lived. And a lot of challenges lay there. One of the reasons is that all her works are untitled. Many of her works are not dated, okay? The mediums are not known, okay? So it becomes more complicated because the artist herself really did not, you know, sign or date or leave such things for us to really reconstruct the entire journey. But that was the challenge, and art historically, that is something that one needs to be doing. So when I was making my initial notes on Nasreen Mohammadi, I met the family, of course, and a lot of help came through sourcing and finding different collectors and collections in which she was there, and putting all this inventory together so that one could think of how we could reconstruct her journey. And I was interested in looking at her life and her journey through as it went along. So here you see pictures with family, friends and contemporaries running in a line. I started with my own memories and experience of Nasreen, if I can say. And I put down the fact that I wanted to create the artist studio, because I believe that the artist, for her, the studio was her restorative space, and it was completely a space for healing. And whenever I went to her house, I was barely 17 years old, and she would call me because she needed to learn Hindi. And if she didn't pass an Hindi exam, she would not get a permanent lecturership. That is how our friendship also began at home. So I used to go, and my sign was three times. If I rang the bell, it is Rubina. So she would open the door, because she would never like to say no to any student who landed up just there. And I would stay with her late evening, and she would be in this space totally uncluttered. Her studio had just this drafting table, which the family has loaned us for this exhibition, the drafting table that she used, and the stool that she sat on. And in the center was a low-hanging lamp, and she would sit there quietly, often not even pulling a line. She would be sitting there and just thinking. And there would be a record player which would play Pandit Bhimsen Joshi, who she loved absolutely. And she, because she was at the college the whole day, she would paint in the calm of the night. And this is how she would be, absolutely uncluttered, clean space. And she talked a lot. She gifted me three books, Dhammapada, Sufism, and Zen Buddhism. And I, in fact, see more of her as a philosopher, because she talked often about emptying the center. And in Sufism, it is very important to really come to a stage where you start your inward retreat, which is called khalwat. And khalwat means basically you go inside, you just have an inward retreat, go in, and through silent reflection, you start emptying out your center so that you become absolutely clean and pure, or become a receptacle for light of knowledge to enter you. And that is how she talked about. And so this room basically is also the initiation for the viewer to prepare themselves for a journey of that kind, of a subliminal kind. In the same room, I have shown four leaves from her pocket diaries. She used to always write pocket diaries and be very secretive about them, actually. But I used to see her jotting down things. And it's very interesting, even when you look at the diaries, it's almost like I have been saying in my essay, in my text, that for her, art was a way of life. It became a way of life. So when you see these diaries, She is sometimes making very mundane entries that some Tayyab Mehta came or Gaitonde came. It was interesting to talk about abstract. And sometimes she would just write very philosophical thing like just telling herself, notes to herself, focus, focus, concentrate. Everything is in concentration, things like that. And it was really like inscription of life on art and art on her life, if when you look at these diary pages. And I found it very interesting to look the way she was drawing her intricate lines on these little pages. And it almost was like she was plotting certain things in words and then blotting them out, you know. And that's something that goes through a lot of her diary pages. When we go into the second room, there are early drawings with watercolors and ink washes, and it's very interesting that her abstraction was nature-based. She used to talk about Kandinsky, Paul Klee, she used to talk about George Matthew, she used to talk about Mondrian and Malevich. And in very interesting ways, the line of thought was very clear, you know. She had a very singular vision and she was looking at abstraction and what all of them had said. And those were the references, but then doing something which was entirely her own. And in this room, basically, she is actually oscillating between a play between linearity and tonality, and then coming to things, understanding really opacity and, you know, looking at the way that you could talk about layers in terms of how would you layer images. But I always feel that she was looking at nature in a very different way, never conventionally, that nature means landscape painting and landscape painting means measuring trees and shrubs and whatever is in front of you. But this was a view of nature which was very different. In fact, I was sharing with some students that when she would teach us, it was very important because she was very eccentric in her ways of teaching, but what we learned from her was the art of seeing things. In fact, she would take us from the room, from our studios, straight to the corridors and tell us, wait, now watch the truck of the, watch the wheel of the automobile move. Or she would make us stand in silence and suddenly say, okay, now watch the leaf dropping of the branch. And those were moments which we had never experienced before. So that was completely a revelation of a different kind, I felt. So something like this, very interesting in the way that she made us think, hear, see, feel. And then when she went to Paris in 1960 and got back, she was doing a lot of collages. And I'm looking at them again and again and finding very interesting things happening there, because there was a lot of things that she was doing, and one thing primarily was about the play between the manifest and the hidden, and how she was doing this through very simple layering and creating many depths on one, just the dimension of the paper, the flatness of the paper. When you come into the central gallery, which is a huge gallery, I've just juxtaposed her drawings with the photographs and created a symbolic passage in between, which also becomes one way of creating pathways around, because this whole area is about her interest in pathways, pavements, streets, runway strips. That's all what she was photographic and doing, and her photographs were never exhibited before. So I thought it was very interesting not to do a linear hang of the exhibition, but juxtapose her interest in her photographs with her drawings and see how they both were speaking with one another. When you come to the other last two rooms, I have juxtaposed her interest in textiles and architecture through photographs and her grid drawings, for instance, and her early canvases. That she painted early canvases, but they were so different. There is always an emphasis on experiencing light and shadow, forms, you know, as they are opaque and hidden, translucent. And I was pointed out, if you see on the left side, you see a little figure almost. It's almost like Nasreen sitting there. Okay, and the way that she was experiencing the space around. So the loom photographs, this is the way the exhibition goes. There are loom photographs. She was very interested in textiles. And I can understand why. And when she would take photographs of looms and threads as they were up and down and the movement of the needle. And in between our drawings, which are also about stitching spaces, how she stitches spaces, you know, so it's a very interesting way of looking at rhythms and patterns, both drawing upon architecture and on textiles. To imagine that this is a drawing done by hand and not something on the computer, which was done in the 1970s, itself talks about how obsessive she was in terms of her working. And to think of a person who has Parkinson and who could not even sit straight, was constantly shifting and moving and lunging and not able to control herself. She was so concentrated to really be drawing these kinds of intricate lines and patterns that was just remarkable, absolutely. And then, just to show you some examples of the economy of the medium that she used. And she always worked in pencil and pen and ink. And even now, it surprises people who come as visitors to this exhibition when they see her works, because she went, I think she never went more larger than this in her drawings. She only went smaller. So you can see she later on went to works which she did of this size. And by this time, I mean, she was, her geometry had become much more expressive. You don't see the grid, but the grid is there. She often used the graph paper because it was very difficult for her to really draw the underlying geometry of that was required for the work. And she started using a very intuitive logic, and the lines are absolutely floating without a structure, without a grid. And that is the stage that she had come to. And because you can't do justice to an exhibition in slides, I'll just end this part by saying that this is one of my texts. What I have done in each room, I have taken a notation from her diaries, and then I have expanded on the idea. So she writes, thought plus geometry minus geometry plus thought, layers plus depths, vast space through complexity of thought, thin threads into space, a pure vision of non-physical space. And in one of the works, when you visit the exhibition, you will see that she has drawn lines which are just indented. There is no pencil, there is no ink, there is no body, there is no matter. She has almost transcended into a non-material world. And so I wrote, from the free-flowing color washes and bold brushwork, Nasreen arrived at an extreme economy of medium, using pen and ink in small format drawings that captured vast expanses and stretches of empty terrain. Her journey became more inward as she moved from the material to the non-material world, from a physical to a non-physical space. Her barely visible lines were reminders of incantations, reverberations of sound, vibrations of light and cosmic rhythms. The airiness of these works mark a spiritual ascent from the ground. The anguish of the mundane is released to embrace a pure vision. So that's Nasreen. And seven contemporaries I'm quickly going to run through because there's no time. So seven contemporaries, this is the youngest, is Ranjini Shetter. And I thought it was a very interesting transition from Nasreen into Ranjini, because she is working with lines and shadows. And these are very undulating lines. She also draws her inspiration from organic, biomorphic nature forms. And it's very interesting, this work. We had to drill 13,000 holes into the wall. And then she has used these, she has made herself these needles with wooden balls. And it's called touch me not, which is the touch me not plant. So it's almost like when you touch the plant, it shies away and it moves and goes in different directions and it is shrinking and withdrawing. And the experience is created by Ranjini by using different sizes of these needles. And actually some kind of a calculation is there in this spontaneity that you see of these undulating lines. It's a very interesting sculptural installation to be experienced. Anita Dubé, and this work is called Intimations of Immortality, and it's a very powerful work. It can't be done justice. It is a very difficult work to photograph as it is installed, because if you photograph it from very far to give it a context, it is not visible almost. But it is porcelain eyes, and it creates kind of a triangle depth, which is, and I think she's using and talking about sexuality, death, and growth, all of those layers into it. Sonia Khurana, you have already seen, but I am just going to emphasize that she has been doing this project lying on the ground for a very long time and in different cities of the, in different parts of the world. Her works are actually to be seen as constellations, you know, of many different works that she puts through. And in this exhibition, she has done World and Lying on the Ground and Logic of Birds. So there is a text that goes along, and the text is like a sound muffle, which is like you are sitting there and listening to your own thoughts. Okay? So that's the way the text runs, but it's a very powerful text about her transgressive acts and how she actually goes and does these chance encounters. Also, the whole sense of loss, the sense of failure, the sense of apprehension, and reaching out. Here she is. Dayanita Singh, you've already met and you know her work. I'm not going to talk much, but what is very interesting of Dayanita in this exhibition is she has put in, she has worked on gelatin prints, and she's almost like worked as an archivist who has looked at all her different series and actually put them together in new configuration, which is very meaningful to her. And then if you see, there are these pegs of nails which you see, which she has just left there. So people come there and believe that we have forgotten to put some frames there, some photographs there, and we have to tell them this is what the artist intended. Because as somebody who works with photographs, she didn't want to really give a sense that once you have put photographs on walls, that's it, the show is over. So every 15-20 days she will be coming and taking out works and putting new works instead. And so she has created structures in which these photographs are lying like shelves. They come out, you can have an intimate viewing, and they can go on to the walls. Sheila Gowda's Margins. And I find this work very, very fascinating. It's almost like aap koi gustaki kar do space mein. You know, it makes you feel as if she's ruptured all ways of looking at space. There is no fixed viewpoint. And Sheila works a lot with recycled, discard objects, residue. And I find it very fascinating that you could actually create a space without any threshold. Okay? And it really resonates with Nasreen in many ways for me, because you see it from whichever angle, it is completely different. Okay? And she's just taken these little old wooden doors and windows and different parts of the house and put them in that space and completely occupied it in a very different way. And the other work that she's showing is Like a Bird. And it's very interesting because here she's working with human hair. So these drawings in space is basically using sacrificial human hair, because human hair that is sacrificed is to ward off evil. So she has collected this sacrificial hair, which is a great big industry, I'm told. And she has actually taken these little thread hair and made these ropes out of it. And of course, it's very pristine because she has herself installed it, and then she calls it Like a Bird. They have axe heads which look like bird, and there could be layers of meaning in it, including domestic clothesline, etc. Bharti Kher, The Drunken Frenzy of Love. I'm not going to talk much about Bharti. You're so familiar with her Bindi series. And sometimes at a very monumental scale, she works at them. And Water Diviner, which already Tasneem had shown. What I find very interesting about Sheba is her practice is very meditative and quiet, quite serene. And even when the environment is very huge, that this is a very ambitious project that she has shown at KNMA, which is in its full form, I believe. And you have, on the one hand, a fountain, which is not visible here, which is the symbol of pure water and purity. And it's the bloodstream of life. And then you have, on the other hand, the huge black elephant, which is the Yamuna River. And in the center, the Delhi Neher, or whatever, the Delhi city. But she creates this kind of a very aquamarine, underwater kind of effect because of the LEDs. And there are 30 tons of books and 2 tons of newspaper, of course fumigated, that have gone into this museum space with her light boxes. And so these are kind of, you know, cascading, you know, landscape that she has created of, it's very symbolic because it's also about plundering your knowledge of the past as well as plundering your environment. So everything is buried. The knowledge that we had, the connection we had with nature, and that is all buried within this water, and so is the environment. Thank you very much.
I think I don't need to say anything. Self-explanatory. This wonderful, wonderful example of a private museum. I think our country needs many more. And many of us probably do not know, Ministry of Culture has come out during Jawahar Sarkar's tenure with a proposal that people, I do not know the details of the proposal, but the ministry gives, I think, money to the tune of 2 to 5 crores. If somebody has some land or a private collection one can build upon, I think you people would be knowing it better. I faintly heard this in a lecture in last year's art fair. Is it true?
What? Yes.
Building fund. So maybe some people sitting somewhere in Himachal or Punjab or Haryana or somewhere in Jammu and Kashmir have this kind of collection or have that desire to build a museum, because our country needs maybe thousands of museums, if not, you know, lakhs. And they have given some kind of, our hope that how museums can be built, run, and how intelligently works can be shown to public. Thank you so much, Rubina ji. Now we open to maybe 10 minutes of questions. After that, we'll have tea. And tea, I think we should not take more than 10 to 15 minutes. Then after that, we have such an intense session coming ahead of us, Vivan Sundaram ji. Then we have Nanak there, Nanak Ganguly. Then, of course, Sadanand Menon. Any questions, please? So who first?
Rubina, I wanted to congratulate you on really a superb exhibition. I was fortunate enough to see it, and I have to tell you it was very, very moving. But I wanted to know a little bit more about your collecting, because you really are one of the few museums in the country, as we were saying earlier, that the NGMA is not collecting. None of the other museums, you don't have museums of modern art. We don't have the budget. So you really are, you and I think perhaps the Devi Foundation, in terms of museums and institutions that are collecting, not private. You know, I know it overlaps in a sense. But can you tell us a little bit more about how you are formulating, what is the logic of your collecting? How do you go about that?
Thank you. Yes, that's a very important question. And we still don't have a board of advisory. As I said, this is still a work in progress. There is an art collector who has a distinct taste, and it's a prerogative also as being the collector. But since the museum has come into existence and the collection has come into the institution or in the museum, we are working on three different kinds of mandates, let's say. One is that we collect more the artists that are already in the collection. For instance, Kiran has a great collection of the core moderns focused on the progressive artist group. So that she has done, and she has done a remarkable job on that, collecting really the best works, or rather the most seminal works of Souza, let's say, or Hussain or Raza, and that of Tayyab and Gaitonde. And I believe she recently also got some very interesting Gaitonde works, and I'm very interested also in looking at Gaitonde doing an exhibition maybe, or thinking in terms of looking at Gaitonde very seriously and what was happening, because Gaitonde in one sense was senior to Nasreen and was also in a way a mentor maybe. So that is one of the things that we are doing. The other thing is we also realize that the museum cannot collect all artists they like. That would be like always a question between depth and breadth. How do you go? Do you really go in depth of collecting, or do you take the breadth? And with India being such a huge country and such great talents, you know, in different regions all over, that has been a question that we have been asking ourselves. And the idea is that at least some of the artists that we are drawn to, we should be collecting in depth. And we started that with Nasreen, actually, that we, in one go, we got four works first, which went to the Museum of Modern Art in an exhibition on drawing. And then we got very, very interested, and then we bought 38 more works of hers. And that is a substantial collection to have of Nasreen's, who is now, of course, very exorbitantly priced and very difficult to get, blah, blah, blah. So this is one thing that we do intend to do, to look at certain artists in depth. And I am stressing the point to her that I would like to look at artists who have not been written about so much, who have really not, who have been great artists as such, who have had great lives, very, very distinct lives, and but they need to be looked at. And so there could be Himmat, there could be Jairam, there could be Gaitonde, there could be many more. So that is one area. As far as emerging talents are concerned, we run the space, the other space in Noida, and we actually invite curators, guest curators also, to curate exhibitions which are not from the collection as such. So that's one way of really looking at what is happening in this whole seamless contemporary scene and practices within the contemporary. And then it gives us also an option and a choice to really acquire works which we get interested in, which are actually showcased at that Noida Museum. So we have recently looked at Asim Waqif, for instance. We have looked at Benita. We have looked at many more artists who are very young and who are practicing, and whose practice is very engaging. So that's one plan, of course. But I think it's very difficult really to make a blueprint which is so perfect and so completely, you know, could happen in one go, because it's something that is going to be evolving over a period of time. And I also feel that there would be a point where somewhere she would also have to look at deaccessioning a little bit of what she had initially collected, which is not really fitting into what one is really looking at. So,
suddenly seeing it as a photograph, I thought of Karl André, and it's almost a Karl André except a few inches higher than what he would have put on the floor. And Karl André, of course, worked with the grid.
Yeah.
But he also made an observation that he was flattening out his sculpture and therefore was interested in landscape. And so if you see in perspective, that actually those squares, when you see the depth, yeah, they actually yeah. start meeting. And the fact that Nasreen's work has been referred to some connection with Agnes Martin in the grid, which she yeah. started with, but the fact that she actually moved away, whether you call it the diagonal or a sense of landscape which was yeah. metaphysical or levitating, is an interesting point. But also just that little thing that Nasreen had a very interesting connection, dialogue with Karl André, and they exchanged letters. And on a more personal thing about the studio and her home, Nasreen Mohammadi, the few books that she had, she didn't have the spine that you saw, which what the title of the book would be. She turned it around. So they were just all white lines.
Yes.
But if you opened her cupboard, and she was always very happy to show you her exquisite saris and the color, and the richness of them, they were so sensuous.
Yes.
And Geeta would always come and they would exchange. So this aspect of loving then the textile, yeah. and its incredible richness, and denying the book its title yeah. and only the line.
Thank you so much, Vivan. In fact, that reminds me that I had so many things to say, but it becomes very reductive when you are actually presenting an exhibition like this. For instance, the idea to bring, the surfaces are all wood and stone in the museum, but I got this black stone because it was something that I saw at Nasreen. The Nasreen's floors were such that they were very clean, they were stone, and she used to love sitting down on the stone, and sometimes there would be reflections over there. And yes, I would love Karl André myself, but it was very interesting. Rob Storr had come from Yale, and he came to see this exhibition, and he stood in the central gallery for a very long time wondering whether Nasreen had created this, you know, because he never, so he stood there and then he came to me and asked me, he loved the studio and it moved him very much, it was meditative and all of that, and said, you've changed this floor, it seems. I said, yes. So tell me, did Nasreen ever make sculpture? So I said, no. So he told me, oh, I was just wondering for a moment, and then and then I told him that I created this kind of a homage or a symbolic passage, you know, which I felt was resonating with.
This door reminds me, you know, or makes me think what Corbusier really had in mind when he designed this auditorium. Either he did not think that we would be making use of it this way, that he didn't know our habits, that we would keep moving in and out during a presentation, or he preempted maybe, you know, Brecht's the theory of alienation. No, he probably wanted us to be alienated from what is going on every now and then. Any other question, please?
And quickly to add, how we have preconceived notions. People came to the to this exhibition. As you know, it was a huge crowd at the opening, but they would not step on this, and they would go all around it, you know, and they would just circumambulate it. And then somebody came and asked me, "Can you walk on this?" I said, "Yeah, sure." And then there was a moment where they felt that, okay, this is something. It's not so, you know, it's not such a sacred art object that one could actually walk and cross over. Yeah.
Very interesting to see that move of a gallery from within the gallery space into a public mall. But that's what I want to ask you about. This ostensible purpose of bringing art closer to the public in one sense. What's your own assessment after a few years of this experience? I mean, is it really working in the way intended, or do you have any ongoing project to sort of... now, for example, I would say the art has not moved to the public, it's moved to the market, mm-hmm. in one sense, in a conceptual sense. And that has its own limitations. People come there for different reasons rather than for the art, and by the way, stray into the space. I've kind of noticed that only during the openings, serious art lovers come in, and then there's a kind of a, you know, lagging off that happens. Now, what kind of process needs to be done in a space like that? It's fantastic that the space is there, but mm-hmm. what needs to be done to activate it and dynamize it in a different mm-hmm. sort of way? Granted, when the LOC was being built, there's a lot of interest and curiosity in what's happening. But otherwise, it's just like any other exhibition being set up. So, have you sort of reflected around this? And, you know, what needs to be done to create that into a much more public sort of area where one can forget the market and enter that in, as a completely different creative space?
Thank you. I'm glad you asked this question, because we don't have an audience or visitorship like Tasneem has, 3,000 visitors, 4,000 visitors. It's quite credible. It's a place where we have to work very hard on viewership, and we have barely 100 people come every day, and earlier there used to be only 10 or 20. That's how we started, and it has taken some time, and it doesn't happen. It's not magic that it would happen, and I'm very aware of this. And being in a mall, actually, it's very interesting, because these are where the urban congregations happen, actually. The malls are places where people all can spend an entire day window shopping, but can still not enter space which is called a museum or whatever. Okay, and they would come till there and turn around. That is also a possibility and has happened. And again, it's very interesting. They come with their bags full of, because after they've shopped, they want to just cross or see what's happening here. And we tell them at the reception that, sorry, you'll have to keep your bags here, because you have to go and see art and enjoy it. Don't carry your burden with you. Just keep it here. And the fact that they are not going to consume anything here is what they feel, because they have consumed there, and they have to leave their bags there, and they're not, what is it that they're going to take, you know, from here? And most times they come, they go through they say they don't understand, that's fine. Sometimes they're just there for a little while and they go. And we go out and we make an effort to tell them something, or tell them, would you like to ask something to us, what we are doing here, why we are here. But the fact that the museum is a not-for-profit, non-commercial space in that sense helps, because it's not a private gallery as such. So people know that here you're not coming to actually buy something. So you have to come here to engage with something, you know, and it's not necessarily with, it has nothing to do with commerce as such in that sense. And gradually this has happened. We have made a lot of effort to going into neighborhood and talking. We did a little pamphlet project to tell them about a museum in this locality. We're doing very little things, and that is making some difference, I would say. And as I said earlier, that this museum, especially, I'm very interested in the contemporary museum, because the fact that it is not just now a repository of objects or can't remain a site of display. It will have to become a place of confluence and dialogue and interaction. That is the way it will survive. That is the way it will go. So there's a lot of emphasis on programs, and these programs which start not just as normal school visits with, you know, students standing in a queue and being taken around, shepherded, you know, to the museum space, but much more in terms of workshops, engaging with them, playing quizzes, making them learn about artists' names, what they are doing, to the fact that senior groups have come, special care people have come, and gradually this audience is growing bit by bit. So programming is something that we do extensively. I did not touch upon that at all, because that is all another area. But it is going to take time, and I keep my hope alive by saying that this is the only way to go, because otherwise it's very easy to say that we can just be talking to ourselves, you know, and be happy about the fact that we are here and we can speak to one another. And I think it will only happen when we go in concentric circles, you know, from ourselves to the local neighborhood, to the city, to another city, to a nation. And that would be the way to really go about.
This makes me, you know, wonder, like many of us must have seen Checkpoint Charlie in, you know, yeah, in Berlin, the museum between East and West Berlin where the wall was. And it's a beautiful museum. It also has a section on Mahatma Gandhi. Surprisingly, before that there is a, you know, a big poster of the American soldier, maybe so-called peacemakers or whatever. And why not a museum maybe on the border, Wagah border, instead of having that parade, which is very obnoxious in its, you know, the way it is done. We could have a museum maybe between Bangladesh and some border in Bengal, you know. We could think of those. Any other question, please? Thank you, Rubina ji.
Thank you,
everybody.
Thank you,
makes us think. What a wonderful, you know, it's a, like, from history of art to criticism of art to how to manage museums, how to, you know, manage maybe tourism industry and you know, havelis and palaces and other discourses on art. Of course, with the, you know, seeing of art. It has been a wonderful experience. Now we will have tea, and after that, a very, very intense, as I said earlier, session. And of course, we are so lucky, so fortunate that we have amongst us, you know, Vivan and Naveena, you know, a continuity of the, you know, legacy of Amrita Shergill.